Well, thank you all. It's nice of you to give up an evening. I often think that people would be better spend it at home watching television. Television is the main source of intellectual stimulation in my life, despite the declining standards. What I have to say, though, I think is in many ways what everyone knows perfectly well, and many people have recognized for hundreds of years, and that's that inequality is divisive and socially corrosive. Are people saying they
speak closer to the mic?
Speak into it more, okay. Actually, one of the ways of starting off talks I found in the past is spilling your water into the laptop, and when I haven't got any jokes, people seem to enjoy that. I tend to do joke-free presentations. I want to start off, though, with this this slide, because look what a miserable lot we are. That's what this picture shows. It's in London, and we look like that when it's not raining. You don't look quite as bad as that even when it is raining. Every person there is scowling, frowning, depressed. Even the ones talking to their friends on the phone are looking pretty miserable. And it reminds me really that in a sense what I'm talking about is the contrast between the material success of our societies and their many social failings. You know, if I'd been living in the 19th century and people told me that by now most people would have had cars and DVDs and central heating, I'd have thought we'd be living in some kind of utopia. And yet, there's really good evidence that levels of mental illness have been increasing over the last generation or so. I don't know about here, but self-harm amongst teenage girls at school, appalling rates. You know, a lot of problems. We worry about drugs and violence and so on, increasing often. And I think that people are often worried about what's going wrong socially and whether they blame teachers or lack of religion or parents. You know, people don't know how to explain this, and there's very little good evidence to know where you should put the blame. But I'm going to be talking about a whole range of social problems, including the ones I've mentioned, and show you that they get worse in more unequal societies, societies with bigger income differences between rich and poor. But although our book is sometimes called A Theory of Everything, because we deal with so many different outcomes, I mean, not only life expectancy and mental illness and drug abuse and levels of violence and the proportion of the population in prison and child well-being and social cohesion and all that kind of thing, it's not a theory of everything, it's a theory of problems that are more common at the bottom of the social ladder. And I think you can look at those problems, and as probably most of the public, you can think, well, we have these social gradients because the vulnerable move down and the resilient move up. But if I was to sort this audience, you know, the upwardly mobile, let's say they go to that end. Let's say all the grey-haired and fair-haired people are the upwardly mobile, the dark-haired people go that way. It doesn't change the proportion of the hair colour in the room one iota. And yet I'm going to show you that any of these problems are between twice as common and 10 times as common in the countries with bigger income differences. And I think that means that these problems are substantially responses to social status differentiation itself. I think people often have trouble with our data, thinking, how can income inequality affect so many different things? You know, obesity and kids' maths and literacy scores and so on. But what we're saying is something that in a sense is very obvious, and not simply that, you know, we've all had the intuition that inequality is divisive and socially corrosive, but that these are, as I said, all problems related to social status in that they're more common lower down the social ladder. And of course, violence and ill health exist at the top. They're just more common further down. And that I'm losing my thread on that one. Having done talks about this four times already today, these social problems are responses to social status differentiation itself. In a sense, our argument is as simple as this, that as you increase the income inequality, you increase the range of these social problems. I've remembered the way I lost the thread, that these problems related to social status differentiation, if you increase the social status differences, the problems get worse. That's all we're saying. Simple as that. I often think maybe I should just show people this slide and that's the message and you can all go home. I didn't draw that. I was very pleased to find somebody else had drawn it on the web. I found it on Google Images, actually. I think the media are concerned with these problems, and they are background worry, the sort of contrast, as I said before, between the material development of our societies, the material success, and the many social failings. What we did was to collect data, internationally comparable data, on as many of these health and social problems as we could find. I'm bothered about the slides, not the, sorry. We collected problems on as data on as many of these problems as we could find internationally reliable sources on. So we didn't actually compile the data ourselves. We didn't decide what data was comparable with which. We simply got it from WHO, OECD, the World Bank, international organizations like that. So people who don't like our data, it's not to us they should complain, it's to these international organizations. We put it together in an index containing life expectancy, kids' maths and literacy scores in each country, infant mortality rates, homicide rates as a measure of violence, proportion of the population in prison, teenage birth rates, levels of trust, obesity, mental illness, which in the standard psychiatric classification includes drug and alcohol addiction. I was a bit surprised that they regard drug and alcohol addiction as mental illness, and some figures on social mobility. We put them all together in one index, just our index of health and social problems, a sort of rag bag, if you like, of all those things that have these social gradients, more common at the bottom of the social ladder. And here the national rates of those things are combined in that one index and related to inequality. You see the countries with the bigger income differences between rich and poor have more of all those kinds of problems. They do consistently worse. And you already know that the United States has worse life expectancy than almost any other rich developed country, despite spending twice as much on medical care as most of the other rich developed countries. It has higher rates of violence. It has higher teenage births. It has higher rates of obesity. It has more people in prison. You know, some countries do badly on all these things, and other countries do well on all these things. You know, the ones, the more equal ones, the Scandinavian countries and Japan, all do well on these things. And basically, what we're doing is trying to account for those extraordinary widespread differences in performance. You know, in the more unequal countries, it's not just one or two things that go wrong, it's most things that go wrong. The measure of income inequality we use is simply this measure that's, we chose it because it's easy to understand. How much richer are the top 20% in each country than the bottom 20%? And you see in the more equal countries on the left, the Scandinavian countries and Japan, the top 20% are 3.5 or 4 times as rich as the bottom 20%. That's the size of the gap. But in the more unequal countries, that include the UK, Portugal, USA, and Singapore, the gap is twice as big. I think we often think these countries are much of a muchness. and not realize that some are twice as unequal on that measure as others. You can see Canada right in the middle of that distribution. So you could be doing worse, but you could also be doing a lot better. In graph after graph, you'll see Canada in the middle, because this is the measure of income distribution we're going to be using nearly all the way through. I showed you this very tight fit. I mean, it looks like something out of physics rather than social sciences, physics with a bit of measurement error. But if you look at the same index, the same measures of how each country performs on the vertical axis, but relate it instead to GNP per capita, you find no relationship. Some of those countries are twice as rich as others. And currencies are converted to take account of prices in each country, so the countries on the right can buy twice as much as everything, and they don't do any better than countries on the left. The same is true for life expectancy. So what this is suggesting is that what matters now is not the average living standards in the rich world, but the differences between us. We were a little bit bothered that people would think that somehow we'd rigged this. I mean, you know, this fit looks as if it just must have been rigged. We thought people would think we'd chosen outcomes to suit our argument. So we did a paper in the British Medical Journal looking at the UNICEF index of child well-being. You can take this as our index of mainly adult well-being. The UNICEF index of child well-being, from our point of view, has the advantage that we had no hand in making it up. It contains about 40 different measures of child well-being. So it includes whether kids can talk to their parents, whether there's bullying at school, how they do in these maths and literacy scores, whether they have books at home, what immunization rates are like, all that sort of stuff goes into it. Here it is in relation to that same measure of inequality. More unequal societies, lower levels of child well-being. I may say, when giving this lecture in the USA, it's quite a relief to be able to show at least one outcome where USA doesn't quite do worst, and it helps them to believe we're not just being anti-American. But again, if you look at that same measure of child well-being in relation to GNP per capita instead of in income inequality, there's no relationship at all. We talk a lot about child poverty being the problem without distinguishing between relative and absolute poverty. But what the data shows so clearly is that what matters is not the absolute level of living in a society anymore in these rich developed countries. It does in the poorer countries, but in the rich world, it's the differences between us that matter now. Another interesting bit of data that makes the same point is that if you do look at life expectancy for different countries in relation to gross national product per capita, you find that it rises rapidly in the early stages of economic growth and then levels off. We still get rises in life expectancy over time, 2 or 3 years additional life expectancy with each decade that passes, but it's no longer related to the amount of economic growth we have. And the interesting thing is that that's true not only of things like life expectancy and many of these problems, but it's also true of measures of well-being and happiness. You can see them flatlining over time while levels of national income double. Although economic growth is what's transformed the real quality of our lives in the past, it's largely done its job. In the poor countries, as I say, it's important to have higher material standards, but for us in the rich world, having more and more of everything makes less and less difference. And the curve I described of income, of life expectancy against GNP per capita flattening off is a curve of diminishing returns to economic growth. I want to show you some of the individual components of our index. You know, I showed them all grouped together, but I want you to have a feel of the kind of fit there is for different outcomes. The first thing I'm going to show you is trust. This comes from the World Values Survey. It's a very simple measure, but for some reason it's used again and again as a measure of social cohesion and involvement in strength of community life. It's the proportion of the population who agree that most people can be trusted. And you see on the right-hand end, amongst the more unequal countries will always be on the right-hand end, you see that it falls to 15 or 20% of the population feel they can trust others. But in the more equal countries, on the left, it rises to 60 or 65% of the population feeling they can trust others. If I showed you some of the measures of involvement in community life, the strength of the social cohesion, the kind of thing Robert Putnam produced in Bowling Alone, or his earlier study of Italian regions making democracy work, exactly the same pattern. So what the data tells us is that that intuition that inequality is divisive and socially corrosive is truer than we ever realized. I may say we did all this work twice. In a sense, we were pretty surprised at the sort of fit we were getting and the consistency of the picture. So we checked it out in a separate test bed. We not only looked amongst these rich developed countries, but we, as a separate test, looked at the 50 American states, asking the same question: do the more unequal states do worse on all these kinds of things? And the picture is extraordinarily similar. Almost everything, almost everything that's related to inequality internationally is also related to inequality amongst the 50 states. So here, for instance, to give you a feel for it, is the data for the American states, the same measure of trust, but this time from the federal government's General Social Survey. A similar range, a similar scatter. This is mental illness. It's not just people coming into their GP and wanting antidepressants or sleeping pills or things to deal with anxieties, because that would be too influenced by whether you pay for prescriptions or access to medical care in different countries. To allow us to make really accurate comparisons of mental illness in different countries, WHO used the same diagnostic interviews on random samples of the population in each country. And you see here, the vertical axis is the percent of the population who had any mental illness in the preceding year. Most of it is presumably less serious things, anxiety problems, depression, and so on. But you see the lowest countries on the left, most equal countries, it's about 8% of the population who had any mental illness. In the USA, it rises to 3 times that level. That means that for every friend that a Japanese person who knows who is depressed, an American would know 3. And you see where Canada is. Slightly more depression than we'd expect for your income inequality, but I'm just pointing out that it'll always be somewhere over the middle of the horizontal axis. This is infant mortality. There's a roughly twofold difference in infant mortality, but that line of best fit, the regression line, you can see to go through most of the countries, it should be a bit steeper. It's being pulled down by Singapore on the bottom right. I never believed that figure for Singapore, but it's what the WHO have for them, so it goes into the analysis. I emphasize that simply because people suggest we've invented these relationships by leaving out data points we didn't like. We've never done that, and Singapore is a good example. I now know why Singapore reports such low infant mortality. It's because about 25% of their population are migrant workers. They're the poorest 25%, and they don't want them to get Singaporean nationality. So they're not allowed to have babies, and they're not allowed to get married. They have a health check every 6 months, and if they get married or are pregnant, they get sent home. So basically what's happening is they take out the section of the population where you'd expect infant mortality to be highest and just remove it from the picture. But still, it's the figure WHO has, so it goes in. I may say that whereas in this one of mental illness, many of our countries are not there, it's because WHO hadn't produced the measures. This one, I mean, is very old data from somebody else. Nancy Ross, actually, working for Statistics Canada, and Michael Wilson, and Jim Dunn, actually. And I'm showing it simply because it has the scatter of American states by inequality and the Canadian provinces. This time, in their data, they put the more equal societies on the left and the more unequal ones on the right. But you can see that scatter of death rates across the American states and then the Canadian provinces more equal with lower death rates. I may say this is the closest sort of, in looking at this age group of working age men, is where you see these relationships closest. If you look at death rates in later life, old age, much less closely related to inequality. This is violence. Again, this comes from Canadians, Martin Daly and Margot Wilson. Margot, I think, died recently, who I think were at McMaster. The red dots are the American states. These are homicide rates, and the Canadian provinces in blue. I think gun ownership is rather similar in Canada and the United States. I guess more of your guns are rural than urban, rather fewer pistols in handbags here. In fact, when we adjusted our international data for gun ownership, we found that the relationships are marginally closer. Doesn't make much difference. I don't mean that you shouldn't control gun ownership, but the countries that do and don't mess up these relationships overall. But look at the scale of differences there. It goes from about 15 homicides per million at the bottom up to 150. There are now about 50 studies of levels of violence in relation to inequality in lots of different settings. It's a robust relationship. This is the proportion of the population in prison. I guess you're beginning to get the idea. Everything's worse in more unequal societies. Up the side, you've got a log scale, which means the top is sort of compressed. Otherwise, the USA and so on would be off the top of the screen. But again, you've got something like tenfold differences in the proportion of the population locked up. And one of the important points about this is that if you don't do anything about inequality, you don't end up by having very low tax rates. You start spending your money on pretty nasty things like paying for imprisonment. There's an interesting paper showing, it's called Garrison America, talking about how some states, American states, have spent more on prisons than on higher education, on how more unequal states spend more on police, and so on. So in a way, the choice about public expenditure is partly whether you spend it on defensive things once you've allowed the inequality to climb, or more beneficial things. I may say this relationship, it's interesting, it's not driven primarily by more crime. There's a bit more crime in more unequal societies, but most of it is more punitive sentencing. And I think, as I mentioned early on, levels of trust going down, strength of community life going down, I think this is another indication that something goes wrong with the quality of social relations in more unequal societies. I don't know whether it's more fear up and down the hierarchy or less empathy, but I think harsher sentencing is another aspect. And also the prison regimes are tougher in more unequal societies. Singapore and USA both retain the death penalty. I think if you've got to go to prison anywhere, you should go in one of the more unequal countries where you'll get some remedial help rather than coming out brutalized. Teenage birth rates, again about a tenfold difference. These are births per 1,000 women in their teens goes from about 5 per 1,000 up to, well, in the UK we have 6 times that level, the USA 10 times that level, Canada, again, a bit above the level we'd expect for your inequality, but you're in the middle again. I'm showing this because we put together a graph looking at bullying from different data, but this comes from Frank Elgar, again a Canadian, who has shown the same relationship between bullying and inequality in a larger group of countries. Interestingly, his correlation coefficient is exactly what ours was on quite separate data. This is the last of the ones I'm going to show you of everything getting worse. I could show you a lot more, and if you want a lot more, you can find them in our book. This is an important one, though, because it's about social mobility. And there's an increasing tendency to say these very large income differences are fair in some sense if people can find their right level in society. You know, if the talented could move up and the less talented move down, it's fair. What this graph shows is actually that social mobility is lower in countries with bigger income differences. The measure of income, of social mobility is basically rich fathers have rich sons and poor fathers have poor sons. It's a correlation between fathers and sons' income, taken from the big cohort studies where they followed kids through in different countries. And what we like to say about this is if Americans want to live the American dream, live it rather than dream it, they should go to Denmark. You know, fathers' income is much less important in those more equal countries. People sometimes talk about the social ladder being steeper with more inequality, or the rungs further apart. I think, in a way, you know, well, those are obviously just analogies, but there are more downward prejudices, if you like, more prejudices against minorities or class prejudice, all those kinds of things, meaning the obstacles to social mobility are higher. So I think, and the lesson of that graph, I think, is if you're really interested in creating greater equality of opportunity for kids, probably the best thing you can do is to reduce income differences, the differences in outcome in the society. I was rather pleased recently to see that Alan Krueger, the chair of his Economic Advisory Committee, showed almost exactly this kind of fit between social mobility and income inequality on quite independent data. I want to come now to point out something that follows from the scale of the differences. I've been pointing out that sometimes countries do twice as badly on some of these outcomes, or in mental health 3 times as badly, but in quite a few of them 10 times as badly. That in itself gives us a clue that it's not just the poor who are being affected by inequality. You know, the bottom 10% couldn't drive such enormous differences between countries. They're so big, actually, because we're all affected by this picture. You know, inequality affects the whole social fabric of a society. You know, there's more, if you like, more status competition, more status insecurity. We judge each other more by status. But we don't just have to infer it from the scale of differences in performance, because in some data we can look at how people perform at each level in the social hierarchy, comparing how they do at that level in social hierarchy in more and less equal countries. This is some very old data, when people first wanted to compare health inequalities internationally, and some Swedish researchers very kindly reclassified a lot of their infant deaths by the British Registrar General's occupational class classification. It's anachronistically, it's a classification by father's occupation, so single mothers have to go in their own group. And then you have fathers arranged by occupational class. the lowest there is unskilled manual workers. Next to them comes the semi-skilled manual workers. In the middle is the skilled manual. Then you move to the junior non-manual, clerical officers, the intermediate non-manual, people like teachers, nurses, and then the high occupational classes, professional occupations, doctors, lawyers, directors of larger companies, things like that. And you see that more equal Sweden, the blue bars, they do have lower infant mortality right across the scale. The differences are biggest at the bottom of society, but even at the top, they do a little bit better. And we've put together, we've found about five or six studies where you can illustrate the comparison like that. But colleagues, for instance, at the Harvard School of Public Health, using more sophisticated methods, multi-level models, they talked about inequality as a general social pollutant because they found its effects go so far up the income scale. This is not just about what happens to the poor. Another example that isn't in our book, but I'll show it to you because it includes Canada. It's old data from Doug Wilms, and it comes originally from the OECD, the Program for International Student Assessment, where they use the same maths and literacy scores for kids in different countries. And instead of being classified by social class, these young people are classified, their literacy scores are classified by how many years of education their parents have had. So on the right, you see young people with well-educated parents, university-educated, who are nearer the top of the social hierarchy. And on the left, you see the kids of people with of people with much less education nearer the bottom of the hierarchy. You see, even at the top, it looks as if perhaps you do a little bit better to be in more equal Sweden than Canada, and better to be in Canada than the US. But at the bottom of the society, it makes a huge difference. But let me point out that this is not about whether there are more poor people or unskilled people or badly educated people in one country than another. It's saying that wherever you are, you do worse. You know, both these things, they don't tell you whether there are more people in one class or another. They say whichever class you're in, you do worse in the more unequal society. Whatever level your parents' education, you do worse in the more unequal society. I think basically what we're talking about is whether our social hierarchy is a steep social hierarchy like that, or a much shallower one like that. That in a way the material differences drive the social distances. You know, we use our incomes to express social status, social differentiation. But with the slightly flatter social hierarchy goes a better quality of social relations, more cohesive society, people trusting each other more and so on. And as I said, that, you know, basically why so many problems have this pattern is because what income differences are doing is intensifying all the ways in which we all know that social class imprints itself on us throughout life, you know, from early childhood onwards. You know, our vulnerability to different kinds of problems, our educational performance, it's affected so strongly by social status, home background, and so on. And what bigger income differences do is make those differences, those processes even more powerful. You know, to talk about trying to produce a classless society without addressing income differences, I think is, you know, it just doesn't wash, it's flannel. I want to say a little bit about what I think is going on in other terms. In a sense, I think you can see this as, we're talking about the psychosocial effects of inequality. You know, I think why Blair in Britain and then one social democratic party after another around Europe and other countries forgot about inequality was because they thought about inequality mattering only in material terms. I think they thought that in the 1930s, when many people were living in great squalor and hardship, then it was quite wrong for other people to be living in enormous luxury. But now we've all got cars and DVDs and so on. Doesn't really matter, does it, if there are other very rich people? But you see, what our data is telling us, in that the outcomes are nearly all behavioral, teenage births, drug abuse, educational performance, crime, these are behavioral things, and it's telling us that inequality has powerful psychosocial effects, and they're to do with those feelings of superiority and inferiority, of feeling valued or devalued, looked up to or looked down on. And I think that, you know, as the income differences get bigger, there are more feelings of superiority and inferiority, more status competition, more status insecurity going with that. And I suspect that, you know, it's not just those sort of societal things, but at a fairly personal level, we all also get more worried about how we're judged, how we're seen by others. What psychologists call these social evaluation anxieties, social comparisons, issues to do with self-esteem, all those problems become more intense. However, really to understand what's going on, I think you have to think more about monkeys than about Marx. You have to think about our evolved psychological sensitivity to social status. I come at this from having worked for many years on health differences between social classes. And the big change in our understanding of drivers of health in the rich developed countries is how important psychosocial factors are. And the three main groups of psychosocial factors are things to do with social status. Social status itself. I don't mean simply having better material circumstances, I mean where you are in the social hierarchy. Weak social connections, any measure of friendship, seems to be highly protective of health. Whether it's the quality of your relationship with your partner, the number of friends you have, whether you're involved in community life, all highly protective. And, you know, it's not just big observational epidemiological studies where you're trying to control out the effect of class and education and so on. It's also in experimental studies where you invite people into the laboratory and you give them nasal drops with cold viruses in. Volunteers, you understand. You give them questionnaires about how many friends they've got. People who are more socially isolated are four times as likely to get colds from the same measured exposure to infection. Or you can make puncture wounds on the back of, again, the hands of volunteers and measure how quickly they heal. They heal more slowly if you have a bad relationship with your partner. And now increasingly we understand the biological effects of chronic stress. And these are all driven by chronic stress. Early childhood is the other big part of this picture. And the way that both maternal stress in pregnancy affects fetal development, how stress hormones cross the placental barrier to affect the fetus, but also early childhood in ways that psychologists have always said are important, but we now know there are biological underpinnings, biological effects of that. But I, looking at these things, I remember thinking, in a sense, they're telling us about the same kind of stress. That in a way, the stresses that go with low social status are rather like the insecurities that you can have from a difficult early childhood. You know, we use many of the same words about anxiety and insecurity and feeling devalued and so on for both of them. One exacerbates the other, or offsets the other. And friendship fits into that because if you've got friends, there are people who give you positive feedback. You feel better about yourself. But if you feel people ignore you or avoid you, don't sit next to you, don't invite you to things, you know, we all start the self-doubts come crowding in. Maybe I'm unattractive, boring. They think I'm stupid, socially gauche. And you see, as creatures, as human beings, dependent on a learned cultural way of life rather than on an instinctively programmed way of life, it's important that we should be sensitive to other people's judgments of us. Because, you know, other people are the bearers of culture. How I learn to behave in acceptable ways is being very sensitive to your judgments of me. It's almost a precondition for being a creature of culture. And some psychologists have talked about our vulnerability to shame and embarrassment as the social emotion, because shame and embarrassment are what make us conform and behave in acceptable ways. So although there are worse stresses in life, I'm losing your home, maybe losing your job, are worse stresses. These worries about how we're seen and judged are much the most common sources of stress. So if you're trying to understand stress in the population as a whole, if you're trying to understand why we, living in unprecedented luxury, talk all the time about how stressful life is, I think it's these issues you have to think about. I'd given that kind of explanation of these factors when I came across a meta-analysis that had gone through over 200 studies looking at the responses of people's stress hormones when they were given stressful tasks to do. So they were having their cortisol level, volunteers having their cortisol levels measured. You could measure them in saliva or blood. They were being given tasks like little mathematical problems. They had to work out. Sometimes you'd have to say what their marks were at the end, sort of additional embarrassment. Sometimes they'd ask you to write about an unpleasant experience you'd had, or video you while you're doing things. But what this meta-analysis, looking at these 200-odd studies of that kind, what they were interested in, is what kind of tasks most reliably push up levels of stress hormones. And their conclusion was that it was tasks that included social evaluative threat. In the paper, they say threats to self-esteem or social status in which others can negatively judge your performance. That's what really gets to us. And it gets to us particularly in modern mass societies where we're no longer part of settled communities. We're having to worry about the impression we create, keeping up appearances and so on. So I think when you think about social status, you know, it's very obvious how it fits into this. So you admired, looked up to, appreciated, valued, regarded as clever, successful, or you looked down on, regarded as trash, regarded as stupid. another way in which these issues get under the skin, there are now a whole lot of what are called stereotype threat experiments, where you give people what appear to be tests of ability, and this is IQ tests, given to people with people from high and low status groups. And you tell one lot, this is not a test of ability. We'd just like you to fill out this form and answer these questions for our research. You tell the other group, this is a test of ability. And you find they do almost as well if they think it's not a test of ability, and a huge gap opens up where they believe it is. You can do the same with gender and ethnicity or class. You can prime people's, remind them in some way that they're part of some inferior group or some group expected to do less well. The World Bank a few years ago published a study that showed this for kids in different Indian castes. They were tested where they didn't know each other's caste and then again where they had to declare their caste. And so, you know, everyone knew who the high and low status kids were, and the results were just like this. I think I've said most of what's on this slide. that income inequality intensifies the idea that some people are worth much more than others. And that intensifies all these social comparisons, insecurities about personal worth, self-conscious emotions, both in terms of people who find it difficult to function in with this sort of what we call social evaluative threat, people who get depressed. Depression, by the way, some psychologists suggesting is a residual of a submission response. If you think about animals in social hierarchies, if you lose a battle for status, the way to avoid conflict in future, you need to be conciliatory, submissive, is by knowing your inferiority. And depression fills you with a sense of being inferior. And of course, you can induce feelings of very like depression by putting people in situations where they can't succeed, you know, whether it's experimentally with problems that they can't solve or whatever. And interestingly also, you treat depression with serotonin reuptake inhibitors, and animal behavior people often talk about serotonin as the social status hormone. So I think that these things come into affect our personal lives in some detail, not just the rates of social problems around us in society. One indication of the strength of these, you know, these heightened evaluative judgments about how you compare with others, some people appearing to be worth everything and others worth nothing, is this from this paper on what they call self-enhancement. We had hypothesized that in more unequal countries, people couldn't afford to be modest about their abilities. On rather little data, we said something like that in our spirit level book. But in this study, an international team of people got people to compare themselves with the average in their country on different criteria. Rather like, you know, how most people apparently say that they are better drivers than average. Something like 90% of the population believe they are better drivers than average. On this, they got people to relate, say, whether they think they're cleverer than average, whether they're more generous than average, a lot of things like that. And you see, people rate themselves more highly in more unequal societies. You can't afford to be modest about your abilities. You have to sell yourself. And that gives some idea of what's going on underneath the surface of these graphs showing that more inequality is related to worse outcomes. I must stop very soon, but I want to point out two things. One that, well, really that to understand this, you need a two-stage model. There's the way these inequality, the quality of social relations, social status is experienced in adulthood. You know, if you get young people coming onto the labor market and you have high unemployment and very low wages, you'll get an increase in teenage birth rates and levels of violence. But you then need to think about how this is passed on to children. That early sensitivity that exists in so many different species, it's about adapting to the kind of environment that you're born into, that you're going to have to deal with. And in human beings, it's about the kind of social environment you're growing up in. And you know, whether you're growing up in a society where you have to fight for what you can get and watch your back and learn not to trust others, because we're all rivals, or whether you're growing up in a society where you depend on reciprocity, on cooperation, on empathy, those need quite different emotional and cognitive development. And that's what some of the early childhood things are doing. You know, the children who get less of the handling, the reciprocity, the eye contact, all the things that you get from loving attention from a parent, are in a sense less socialized. But they grow up to be more streetwise, better able perhaps to look after themselves, fight their corner. So you need to think of both those levels. And we now know that there are important epigenetic processes triggered by differences in the early environment. They've been shown now on a massive scale in some non-human primates, and we're beginning to see the same things in human beings, that effectively genes are being switched on and off by the social environment. Changes in gene expression, not changes in your genetic code, but changes in what they do to you to allow for different developmental trajectories. So this is what's been happening to Canadian inequality, data from Statistics Canada. You know, since the mid-90s or early 90s, you've had that growth in inequality. I think I'll leave what we do to about it to maybe questions and other people's suggestions. I may say that I do think that inequality is a major obstacle if we're ever going to deal with carbon emissions and global warming, because the main threat to reining in carbon emissions is consumerism. And consumerism is about status competition to a large extent, and it's intensified by greater inequality. We find more unequal societies. People work longer hours because money is even more important. It's how you show what you're worth. But also, people in more unequal countries save less of their income. They spend more. They get into debt more. The other link is that more equal societies are also more public-spirited, which is a precondition, I think, for acting on these global issues. So I hope we can turn our society from being as miserable as that to something a bit more convivial like that. If you haven't had too much already, this, you know, each chapter in the spirit level takes one of these problems. It shows the international evidence, shows the American state evidence. It goes into more detail on the causal links. And the Equality Trust contains ideas about campaigning. It contains most of these slides if you want to use them. Thank you.